Okay, good afternoon everyone. I'm going to talk about my project and you might choose as well, correct? So please look here. So this, I have four projects here. One is a different project and other three are related. So I'll talk about the three projects after this presentation. Let's talk about this one. The project name is Learning Objective Repository, correct? And it is, we will mentor it, me and Mr. Nages, hope you know him, correct? So, who knows here? What is a learning objective? Can anybody tell me what is the meaning of learning objective? So, how many of you watch videos on YouTube to learn something? Okay, good. So, how many times it has happened that you wanted to learn topic one, correct? You started searching for the videos for topic one, you tried to learn it, then you realize that this topic is not as much important as topic two. So, you jump to topic two. While watching the video, you get the idea that this topic two can be learned only when you learn topic three. So, you switch to topic three and the whole day is spent like that. You switched from topic 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 and at the end of the day you learn nothing, correct? So how many times have you faced this problem, or at least once? Please raise your hand if you have faced this problem. Okay, good. So this learning objective repository can help you in solving that. So let's learn what is the learning objective first, then only we will come to know how it can solve the problem and what we are going to do in this project. A learning objective is a simple statement that starts with, after completing this tutorial, a student will be able to, and you need to complete the sentence. So that's a learning objective. For example, after completing this tutorial, a student will be able to create a blank HTML page. So if there is a video, or there is a class, or there can be a text manual, before that it is written that the learning objective of this tutorial is to teach you how to create a basic HTML page or blank HTML page. You will know what you are going to learn and it can save you a lot of time, correct? Similarly, there can be a learning objective like, after completing this tutorial, a student will be able to install Python 3 in Ubuntu 18.04. So now you know that if you have Ubuntu installed on your system, only then you need to watch this video. Otherwise, what you will search? Install Python, correct? You will not know that you have to learn Python 2 or Python 3, or you want to install it on which machine. But because this learning objective is written before the tutorial, so you know that whether you need to watch this video or it is relevant to you or not. So you can decide to watch it or you can skip that. So this learning objective is basically a starting point of all tutorial. Although there is a problem that neither the teachers nor the students are using it. Correct? Did you know about the learning objective before I told you? No? So students are not using it and very few teachers are using it. So my idea is to create a learning objective repository. Because somebody has to write the learning objectives, correct? It's not easy to write learning objective. We have to think from different aspects, from different angle. We have to think from different version of software, for different operating system versions of the software, of the OS, and many other things needs to be considered before we write learning objectives. So there are teachers who are writing learning objectives around the globe and they are saving it in. If you write something, where do you save it? In general. So where do you save your reports? Where do you save your reports? Nobody saves the report. Word document, correct. So teachers are doing, they are saving their learning objectives in Word file, or let us say Google Docs or some other document format, which is not reusable. The learning objectives written inside a document are not reusable, because if you have written a learning objective, if you have maintained a document, he can't use that, correct? Because nobody knows about the document you have created. You might have put a lot of thoughts before creating or before writing those learning objectives, but other teachers do not know about it. So how will they use it? They can't use it, correct? So my idea is to create a learning objective repository. So if teachers want to write learning objective, they will write on repository rather than on Word document or text format, correct? So they will write it here, and this learning objective repository will be REST API enabled web service. So what we will do, we will put it somewhere. Let us say learning objective IITB dot something, correct? It will be available there. So if there is a platform, educational platform, who provide tutorial or who write tutorials? For example, you know about NPTEL, you know about IIT Bombay X, Spoken Tutorial, have you heard about it? So these three are already there and somehow related to IITs, correct? And we have a lot of tutorials on NPTEL, IIT Bombay X and Spoken Tutorial. So if we have a centralized learning or objective repository, these systems, NPTEL, IIT Bombay X, Spoken Tutorial, they will fetch learning objectives from here rather than writing their own learning objectives. So rather than writing their own learning objectives, they will fetch from here. So why we are doing it? NPTEL could have write their own learning objectives. They can write their own learning objectives, but if they will write it there, IIT Bombay X will not be able to use it. While both are teaching same courses, same topics, correct? And it also does not matter which teacher is teaching the topic. One topic can be taught by n number of teachers, and all teachers can use same learning objectives. So this is why it is very important to put those learning objectives in some repository. So these were the current scenarios where we can directly use it. Other than that, what we can do, we can create Moodle plugin. Moodle, if you are not aware of it, it is a learning management system. So you can think it as Udemy. Okay, you know about Udemy. So there are many tutorials on Udemy. So if Udemy wants to incorporate the learning objectives into their website, how they will do it? They will communicate with the learning objective repository, search for the learning objectives and fetch it and display it there. Correct? So this is why this learning objective repository is important. Now, what's the importance for that? I have already told the importance for you, because it is, you are going to save a lot of time if you know what are the learning objectives you need to cover in order to complete your subject, or in order to learn a language, correct? Or in order to get a job. It can be anything. For educators, they will know what to teach in a tutorial. So have you seen tutorials which are 1 hour long on YouTube, on Udemy, on Coursera, on many other websites? Have you seen the videos of 1 hour long? Do you like to watch the videos? 1 hour long videos? So people do not like it. They want short videos. But in order to make short video, teacher need to know what exactly he or she need to teach in a video. They do not know because they do not have learning objectives. If they have learning objectives, they will know what they need to teach. And if they have learning objectives, they will never make a tutorial which is longer than 20 minutes. Right? Most of the time they will make videos which are 5 minutes to 7 minutes long, which most of the successful educational YouTubers too, correct? So it will save a lot of time for the educators as well. Now let's talk about the technology stack. Now you know that what we are going to make. We are going to make a learning objective repository. So what we are going to use in order to make the learning objective repository? It can be a Java based system or it can be a Python based system. We will select any of one of these, okay? It depends on what you know. So how many of you knows Java? Please raise your hand. Good. And how many of you knows Python? Oh, good. Almost same number of people. Good. So what is your knowledge with Java? So how many of you are aware of object-oriented programming? Good. So you know REST APIs? Anybody here who knows REST APIs? Okay. Who knows Django? One. Good. Who have heard about Flask? I know none of you knows. So if you know Flask, we can go ahead with that. This is the one of the best system used to make microservices. Or if you are interested in Java, we can also go with Spring Boot. How many of you know about Spring Boot? Heard about Spring Boot? One, two, okay. So we can, yeah, three, good. So then we can go ahead with that also. It all depends on what you like. If you like to code in Java, we will go with Spring Boot. If you like to code with Python, we will go with Flask. Django is not my preference. And we will use MongoDB database. Does not really matter which technology stack we are going to choose. And other requirements are good knowledge of object-oriented programming, REST APIs. If you do not know, there is nothing to worry about. We will learn it. It's not a big deal. So other thing is SQL, and knowledge of Git is really mandatory for managing the project as well as for your career as well, correct? Now, what you are supposed to do if you want to select this project, you are supposed to learn a lot, because as I come to know that many of you have heard about Flask, but you do not know about REST APIs. So unless you know about REST APIs, it is difficult to work. So you will learn a lot, you will code a lot, okay? You will debug and test your code, or maybe others' code as well. And then I also want you to read some research papers and write one at least. Okay. So this is the task that I believe most of you should be able to do. And we are going to mentor this, me and Mr. Nagesh, and these are our email addresses, you can write down. So we need 4 interns for that. I don't know how many can be assigned to this project. That you just apply and then we will select. Okay. So my second project, actually other 3 also, are related to this topic only. So the topic is ask a question in video format. Okay. So do you ask questions online? Any of you? Please raise your hand if you ask questions online. Okay. You don't ask? Nobody asks question online? That means you do not work. You ask, then why aren't you raising your hand? Okay, I'm not asking that you are asking in video format. I'm saying that if you ask question on internet, please raise your hand. Okay, good. So where do you ask question? Which platform? Stack Overflow, Quora, and Google Plus community, Slack, Reddit, WhatsApp, correct? Okay. So I want people ask questions to me as well. Okay. So here's a question. How to send an SMS from an Android smartphone? Okay. So what will you do? There are 3 choices. Please raise your hand like this if you are going to say 1. If you're going to answer, raise your hand like this. Otherwise, like this. Please raise your hands now. Okay, so those who are not raising your hand, I am believing that you are not on internet. Please raise your hands. Please participate. Otherwise, you will not learn. Correct? The next 1 month is about participation only. The more you participate, the more you learn. Okay, so everybody is going to answer. I say, okay, 2. Ignore the question as this is too easy. Good. Actually, yeah, please. Now you can put down your hands. So the thing was, I actually missed one slide, which did not have this image, okay? So I wanted to ask if you will answer this question or not, and I was believing that most of you will answer 3, okay? But now, because you know who asked this question, many of you changed your answer to 1, will answer the question, and some of you are saying 2 because it's too easy for them. Without knowing the person, without seeing the image or video of a person, if you receive this question in text, most of you will answer 3. Okay? Let me ask another question. So what can make a car faster? Asked by this fellow. What will you do to answer this question? You have to answer the question. What will you do? I know you are not mechanical engineer, correct? Or automobile engineer, but you are supposed to answer this question. What will you do now? Participate. Research on internet. Yes. Yeah, research on internet to answer this question. Anybody else? There's no Fast and Furious fans here. correct? Ask somebody to answer the question, correct? So this is what most of the people do. What if the same question is asked by this fellow? Now, what will you do? So, tell me, what will you do now? Ignore? Why? See, most of us knows, but I want to hear the answer. Why? Say it loudly. You are saying right, but please say it loudly. He already knows the answer, correct? We know it, so we will skip the question. So what makes the difference? By knowing who is asking the question, okay? You know whether you have to answer, you have to ignore, or your answer will change according to the person. So what are the factors that actually help us, help a teacher in answering a question? There are many factors. I haven't listed down all of these, but I have listed down some. So expressions, age, gender, geographical location, and there are many other factors. These helps in answering a question correctly. And unfortunately, all of this are missing on Stack Overflow, Quora, YouTube comments, WhatsApp, Reddit, Google Plus, correct? Most of them miss all of these. There are no expression, there is nothing, correct? So asking a question in video format will help teachers to answer the question correctly. Do you believe it? Okay. So I have three projects which are related to this only. All are independent. No project has dependency on any other project. And I need different set of people to work on three different projects. So one is the Raspberry Pi based hardware to ask question in video format. So who knows about Raspberry Pi here? 1, 2, 3, 4, good. So what I am trying to do here, the idea is to create a hardware based on Raspberry Pi with camera. The hardware will help a student to ask a question by recording a video. So it will work like this. The one who wants to ask the question will record the video and submit it with the spoken tutorial ID. So forget the spoken tutorial ID here. So let me give you the idea like this. So there is a device installed on a school, a college, correct? It's a hardware, a small hardware like this size. A student come near to this. If you want to ask question, there's a button. He will press the button, ask the question, submit the button again. That's it. After he clicked on the button, the question is recorded and the question will be shared to cloud. This is the first project, which I am saying Raspberry Pi based hardware to ask questions in video format. So it will help in installing a device or basically connecting students to teachers in remote areas also, where there is no good internet connection. So we need to create algorithms on Raspberry Pi with Python or with some other language that we have to figure out somehow. OpenCV is a library. Hope you have heard about it. If you haven't, we will work on it. We will try to find out how to compress the video so that it's easier to send it to cloud. If videos are not sent in given time, then how to manage storage, because the storage on the Raspberry Pi will be limited. It will be 32 GB or 16 GB, not more than that. Then how to manage that? Then once the video is synchronized to the cloud, how to recognize it and delete the video? Okay. For this, we have to work on this hardware. You get the idea? And me and there is one more person, Mr. Rajesh Kusalkar, we will help you in creating this hardware with Raspberry Pi. So other project is again related to this, but it is creating an Android app for the same thing. So what we are doing, we are creating a hardware in the first project, correct? In second project, what we are doing, we are creating an Android app, which will work similar. There will be a interface where you can see your video. There will be a button. You will click on that, ask your question, Again click it, it will send it to the cloud. So again we need to work on many things. Like first we need to create the app, search for storage, try to compress the video, send it to cloud, remove it from here. Like all of this needs to be done with the app, correct? And there will be many things because hardware will be installed on few places. Like the whole school will have only one hardware, or whole college will have only one hardware, but the app will be with everybody, correct? So the number or amount of videos which are going to synchronize on cloud will be higher than all hardware combined. So we need to find how to manage space, how to manage our resources, and how to do it effectively. With the app, we will also have the liberty to synchronize the answer of that video as well. With the hardware, we are unable to send the answer via internet, correct? But if you have installed an app which allow you to ask a question in a video format, you expect to get your answer back. So we can do that as well. Similarly, this app will have two versions, one for student and one for teachers. Or we can also make one application for both, means you can ask as well as you can answer, the way it happens on Quora or Stack Overflow. So you might receive notification on answering questions which are relevant to your interest, then you can answer accordingly. If you answer a question, the system should be able to identify that what you know about, correct? In that case, you will start receiving more notifications related to your topic. This all has to be programmed into the application, correct? So we need 6 people to work for this because there are 2 versions, one for student and one for teachers, correct? Let me know if you have any question about this application. And we are going to make it, I want to make it work on iOS as well as an Android. So I'll prefer Java or some other language which can compile to both. So let's now talk about the third project, which is again related to this only. So it is about analyzing the question videos. So what will happen, all the videos, whether they are asked by the hardware or asked by the application, will be synchronized to cloud. Now cloud have a lot of videos, okay? So if you remember, when students were asking questions with the hardware, we did not ask their names, we did not ask for the age, we did not ask for the gender, we did not ask for the topic. They simply asked their question and submitted it. Now the question has no data except the device or device number from where the video was asked. Now our work is to analyze the video frame by frame. Try to find out age of the person who asked the question, gender of the person. Location can be detected from the hardware itself, because when we are installing hardware, we will fix that. Number of the hardware, location of the hardware, correct? We can work on identifying expression. What was the expression? He was curious, he was joking, he was laughing. Think of anything, correct? You don't want to send laughing videos to teachers, right? So it needs to be very good, otherwise nobody is going to use it. Then there are many things like topic, one of the most important thing. So how we are going to get the topic? We might process the audio, convert the audio into text. From the text we can try to find out the topic, we can try to find out the label. So like class 6 standard student asked this question, or class 7 student asked this question. This is also important if you want to send the video to a teacher who is going to answer the question, correct? So this all things we need to do it when the video is synchronized to cloud. So for that we might need knowledge of NLP, we might need to know about machine learning. Actually I do not know, you need to find out what is required. We will find out together and then we will work on it. So Python has most of the libraries, so this is why I have selected Python for this. OpenCV is definitely we have to use if we are going to work with the videos. Then the common things are knowledge of Git, NLP libraries, Python. Okay. and we need 4 people for this. Thank you.